Hi, I'm Paris, and yes, I've lost about 55 pounds over the past 10 months. I am thinner, but not thin. I am wearing size medium shirts now, kinda. You can see the belly's still there, so I still have a ways to go. In this video, I'm going to focus on one of the concepts that I've learned that I wish someone had explained to me two or three decades ago that I think would have made a lot of difference. I wouldn't have put on the weight in the first place and had the health issues that came along with that. Where I learned this concept is in this book, Why We Get Fat and What to Do About It by Gary Taubes. I've probably read a dozen books or so on the topic in the past few months, but this one is one of the two I most highly recommend, and I'll link to it down below this video. Getting through the first half of it, it's kind of a slog because the author has to go through example after example, trying to break down in your mind and change the way that you think about overeating and being fat. And when your mind is finally open to considering other ways of looking at this, in the second half of the book, the author explains, gives that explanation I said I needed 30 years ago that tells exactly what happens when you eat, where the sugars and the fats all go, get distributed, how that all works. And once you understand that, it really affects the way you look at what you're about to eat and put into your body. And let me add the disclaimer, I am not a doctor, I'm just relating anecdotally what worked for me. If you decide this might work for you, you should discuss changing your lifestyle or diet with your doctor first. So what's the concept that you have to unlearn? It's basically this, that calories in, calories out isn't the way to look at weight loss and nutrition. You can eat 2,000 calories of this food and you will actually add to your fat stores. You can eat 2,000 calories of a different food and your body will actually end up thinner. In both cases, it's 2,000 calories. What matters is it's 2,000 calories of what? So let me step back a little further in my explanation so maybe you can understand it the way I came to understand it. But keep in mind, in a 10-minute video, there's no way I can do justice to what the author took a few hundred pages to spell out. So a lot of what happens to the food that enters your body is determined by hormones, especially insulin. And I happen to be insulin resistant. This came on a couple years ago, and I'll show you some of my test results so you can see what happened there. And I'm happy to report that having changed my diet and lifestyle, my insulin resistance is now less. But it's a big problem in America. A lot of people have insulin resistance and aren't aware of it. Insulin resistance can be happening before you get to the point where you poke your finger into that blood glucose test and find out that your blood sugars are no longer under control. It means that the system that your body uses to determine what to do with the fats and proteins and carbohydrates that you consume, it's a little bit off balance. And what should happen is that a certain amount of insulin should be enough to get your cells to open up and be receptive to receiving in glucose, for the fat to go to the various places that it's supposed to go to. But when your cells develop insulin resistance, when the insulin comes and knocks on the door of the cell and says, hello, we've got some glucose here we need to send in, the cells, they don't want to hear about it. And they don't want to be disturbed so often because it's all the time now that the insulin is coming and asking them to let the glucose in, or there's just so much glucose. Glucose, though it fuels your body, it actually is toxic in high levels. That's why your insulin level is so important. And so after so many months or years or decades, it depends on the person, your body is just deaf to the call of insulin saying, hey, you've got to let the glucose in. So the glucose then goes up in your, the glucose level goes up in your bloodstream. If you happen to poke your finger and take a little strip and measure it right then, you'll see, oh, my blood sugar is kind of high because it isn't being taken into the cells. So what can your body do? It's got to get that sugar out of there. So it sends out more insulin, which then knocks harder on the door of the cells. They finally open up and let the glucose come in, which is okay for today. But what about tomorrow when knocking harder doesn't do the trick? Now the body's got to release more insulin to pound on the door so they'll let the glucose in. So you can see how your cells develop that insulin resistance, which can get to the point where your body is producing insulin as fast as it can and it still can't bring the level of sugar in your blood down. So you have to go and get more insulin at the drugstore and you have to inject it into your body so you can bring those blood sugar levels down. So what's that got to do with being fat? Well, having the extra insulin in your system, extra hours of every day, insulin does other things in your body, including directing what happens with the fat. or more specifically, the fatty acids that float through your bloodstream, well, they end up, when you eat them, getting directed into fat cells. Now, not necessarily as a long-term storage where you see yourself putting on weight as you're eating. They get stored there so that once all the glucose is used up in your system, you need energy. So those fatty acids can relatively easily come out of the fat cells, get circulated around, and used for fuel. When those are mostly used up, then you actually start to feel hungry again. Now the science gets a little more technical here. Better to read the book so you can really understand it. But the insulin determines whether those fatty acids stay in the fat cells or are kept in a state where they can come back out easily into circulation. If they stay in the fat cells, they get grouped together, three of them sort of locked together, which makes them too big to fit through the fat cell membrane. So at this point now, they are locked in there for long-term storage. So to overly simplify this, while your insulin levels are getting higher and staying higher for longer periods during the day, the fatty acids that go to the fat cells for temporary storage more and more end up in long-term storage, which means they fill up those fat cells, and then new fat cells are created for the next wave coming in. So how do you get your body to unlock those triglycerides, the three fatty acids hooked together, so they can fit through the cell membrane, come out of the fat cells, be burned up, and you end up with fewer fat cells? Well, one way that people have discovered is the keto diet, where you avoid carbohydrates or keep it very, very, very low. So if you're not consuming the carbohydrates, your body doesn't have to have that let's pump out the insulin response to keep the blood sugars low. You are still consuming calories, but in protein and in fat, so your body does things a little differently. And that helps to change the signaling inside your system. Again, it's complicated, read the book, but it allows your body, instead of storing the fatty acids as three together and being locked away, it allows them to become unlocked and float out of the fat cells. Now, did I go on a keto diet to lose weight? No. And why not? Well, because of health issues I had already developed, I needed to go on a vegan diet. And through another book that I read, which I'll discuss later, I decided to cut out all fats and oils. And admittedly, some of the points in that book, Preventing and Reversing Heart Disease is the title, are at odds with the key points in this book. And of all the books I've read, I haven't bought in 100% to any individual book, but I've found good points in each book, and I've sort of assembled them together in here and used that to affect my lifestyle and what I eat, and it has worked for me. So, okay, I didn't do keto, though I have a friend I mentioned in the first video who took that approach also about a year ago, the start of this year, I guess, and has lost 50 pounds. And the main element of our diet that we have in common is actually a point I've seen pretty much in common of every single book I've read, which is to cut out added sugar, to cut out refined grains, and to cut out as much as possible heavily processed foods. Your body goes nuts with those kinds of things, by which I mean it loves them. It's instant energy. Having a spoonful of sugar, that only helps the medicine go down, that helps everything go down. That's why you have the taste for it. It's energy, and if occasionally you splurge like that, it would probably be okay. It's just that for so many people, myself included, it became a daily splurging. So we were overtaxing our system's ability to deal with pumping in that instant energy, because the insulin has to go really high to get those blood sugar levels down, because again, that's toxic in your system if it's out of control. So it annoys the cells so often that they say no, you develop the insulin resistance, your insulin levels stay high longer time, the fat distribution, instead of being a temporary storage, becomes a permanent storage, you get big. So how do you get unbig? Well, for me, again, I wasn't doing the meats and I wasn't doing any oils, so I had a limited number of foods I could work with, and so my diet was actually high in carbohydrates. It still is, about 70% carbohydrates. But the carbohydrates I eat are not in the form of that instant energy. They do still provide energy, but they're mixed with other things because for the most part, they're in natural sources that have fiber, water, other things with them that slow down the absorption. So the insulin level doesn't shoot sky high and continue that insulin resistance that I had. Instead, it's one of these deals. And just as it takes a while to develop insulin resistance, it takes a while to develop your insulin sensitivity again. My most recent test results from just last month, my insulin levels, fasting insulin, was down to 12. Well, that's a major improvement, and my doctor was very happy about it, but my levels are still not normal. Below 8 is normal, and well below 8 is considered better. Now, intermittent fasting can help out with this as well. I can't manage to go a day or two without eating, but I did find I could do at least 12 hours, and so I instituted that into my lifestyle. I'll talk more about that in another video, but the idea is it gives the cells a chance to rest where they're not being knocked on that door with the insulin saying, I got some work for you to do. So how do I eat a diet that's 70% carbs and yet improve my insulin sensitivity so that I can lose weight? Well, in my next video, I will take you through a day of eating with me so you can see firsthand and get some examples from that. So if you want to understand what's going on behind getting fat and behind being able to lose weight, I really recommend this book. It explains it so you can keep that in your mind when you're thinking about what to eat. That really helped me a lot. I'm a logical person, and so understanding the why of it really helps me decide to push that food away and pull over some more of this food. But if you're more of a person who's show me what to eat, I'll give it a try and see how it works. Well, that'll be in the next video, and I'll see you there soon.